the Spirit of God, how you have shown yourself strong on the behalf of those whose hearts are perfect before you. Father, you're the strength of our lives, and all we are complete in you. All good and perfect gifts come from you. Father, we thank you for the work that you've begun in us. You who have begun the good work, you shall continue to put our eyes on you. You're the author and you're the finisher of our faith. We thank you today. Hallelujah for the victory. But this is the victory. This is the victory that overcomes even our faith. Standing on your promises, and all of your promises are yea and amen. We give you praise and the glory tonight in Jesus' name, the name above every name. The name that's been highly exalted, exalted above all names. Father, let's sing with a shout. Hallelujah. You are worthy tonight. Shira Benisha. Shibidi. Shalamanosi. You are worthy. Shiri Bini. To receive glory. You are worthy of wisdom. You are worthy of, hallelujah, of praises, honor, blessings, and wisdom. Lord, you are worthy tonight. Thank you. We give you praise because you have given us that name to use against the enemy. Name to use in prayer. Name to use, Lord, whenever we do anything in your name, Lord, you say that you will be in the midst of it. We thank you, God. We give you praise and the glory tonight in Jesus' name. Everybody just say it, Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. Amen. All right. I want to begin by mentioning being so faithful and consistent in prayer and Bible studies. All that you do. And I don't think that this ministry could be what it has been for all of these years. We could have survived without dedicated and concentrated people that love God and that support the work of the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Many churches have gone through a lot of changes. Y'all know how they'll all come and they'll be known. Spread themselves like a great fig tree. The Bible says the effectual fervent prayer by a righteous man does well. How in prayer there's something in the prayer. So we want to utilize our strengths this coming week, next week, and we have decided, and I've already got something in my mind I want to share, that can make this a very powerful event. This is just going to be 3 days, but I think the timing of it is good because it's preparing you for Christmas in a lot of different ways. You'll be more Christ-minded, spiritual-minded, and maybe a few pounds lighter as a result of not being focused and focused on food. And I've already begun to get into that that spirit. And I was surprised. Sister Neal and I, we thought about 2 or 3 weeks ago, so we want to lose a lot of weight, maybe 20 pounds. And as we said, what we'll do, we start eating out. We just start buying one entree and split. Man, that worked good at Cracker Barrel. It works good everywhere. And just keep having them out. I'm just dropping pounds right along. Amen. So I really want to get back in control. I think that this is a very important self-control. And I think that we ought to be able to determine whether food will lord it over us or not. I think perhaps the greatest barrier to spiritual progress, one of the greatest barriers, is going to be the inability of believers to temperate themselves many times in food. That's been the problem. Go all the way back. What caused the first sin to evolve? What caused Noah to fail? He got drunk. Intemperance. If you go all the way back, you find that most of the major sins, even in Sodom, the Bible says that in 1649, it said that they were people that that were servanting community sins. It wasn't the sodomy, it wasn't the homosexuality in itself, it wasn't all those bad things that they listed, there, but the main problem, the mother sin of it all, was the inability to control your appetite. Amen. So I know that this is going to be the key for us to get the breakthrough that we need. Many times I marvel at what some people don't break through, whatever the obstacles or whatever barriers or whatever they are. I'm confronted with and just let go and let God. But many times you are not able to do that because of the hold that food has on you. So we want to just start gradually. How many believe we can do it gradually? How many believe? Amen. Nobody would. I just want to do it all of a sudden. But, you know, we're going to have to get away from when we go out to eat and when we eat here, piling these plates up so high. I know almost like food, you know, and I like to eat, live to eat, need to live, I guess, but it really has a big barrier on your spirituality, because I know when I get overcharged with food, I don't have no appetite for spiritual things. And I eat and then I what? Start not. And so we want to try gradually next week get into that fasting and consecration vein again. We haven't called for a fast in a long time. We haven't talked about it a whole lot, but I think that this is the season that we really need to begin to seriously consider fasting and prayer because of the conditions that exist all around us. There are people need to be saved, and there are scores of people that need help right in our midst. Need a lot of help. And I was just thinking, if I had to try to control my appetite the little bit I do, I wouldn't have a desire to do what I do. I would have that desire. It would just be, something that you just do, without your heart being in it. But that's the thing that keeps drawing me in, keeps me with compassion, keep me with a concern about other people, and make me submit to things that I wouldn't ordinarily do, like meeting with people on a consistent basis. And just working with them over and over and over until we can see some progress coming forth in their lives. But it's the spirit of consecration that has kept me all of these years. Amen. Even my marriage, and we've been married 50 years. But we started out our marriage fasting because I was away from my wife the first year or so because she was still in college and I was teaching school away from home, about 50 miles from home. And so I did a lot of fasting because I had just gotten saved and I knew that it would actually require me to really get control of my flesh because I wasn't in control of it beforehand. But the fasting and prayer helped me to lead a victorious life. And I remember then, I wish I could do it, like 3 days with nothing. And 7 days, I remember on a 7 day fast, that's when just before John F. Kennedy got shot, God just showed me all of that. And all of, you know, I just saw the end of the country and how eventually the country will end up being overtaken by a foreign enemy. And I just saw all of that. And God just showed me many things. And I believe that if we could kind of push the plate back a little bit and really begin to seek God from our heart, amen, with an appetite that we can kind of temper, I think that things will begin to break forth again for us. How many want to see God do some mighty things?
Amen.
Amen. I want to ask you tonight to respond. Give this from Brother Donaldson. He always asks us questions in our marriage class. Start out with asking us a lot of questions. Amen. But I want to just get some response, because next week will be three serious days, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. You know, I thought about that, and maybe that's just too hard on the saints. That'd be too much prayer, three nights straight. And some will be here Tuesday night, some will be here Monday night. And I talked with Sister Deborah this evening. She said, no, God put 3 days in my spirit. I said, I'm going to be there Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Amen. So, you know, we used to stay all night on Friday night. That's not so we used to go out of style. How many remember staying all night on Friday night sometimes? Amen. All of us got old and things have crept up on us physically, so sometimes, you know, we can't hang like we used to hang. But I'm really expecting the men to help us in this special three-day consecration. This will be just the beginning of a real serious season of consecration. Because if we want to see miracles, if we want to see a change in our community, Brother Williams is reaching out to the community now. And you don't want a church full of people without a church that's really serious about consecrating. So many needs that God only can meet, and they're going to come as a result of what fasting and prayer and us acting, amen, and walking in love. So I want to say that we have some brothers here that's really powerful in prayer. In fact, all of them are powerful. How many brothers will say
amen?
Amen. So, how many would like to see the brothers lead out? Get about a dozen of them praying in the Spirit, and I believe that would launch the three-day, and of course, January will probably go much further than 3 days, but we do want to see brothers leading out in prayer, praying in the Holy Ghost. Amen. That will be Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday night. Friday night goes to 12, so be it. Amen. I'm all for seeking God now. Today I heard about this another shooting. I heard about that today?
Yeah.
And I don't know what's going to stop all of these shootings except the power of God.
Amen.
I think God's people got to get together and what? And pray.
Amen.
There's nothing they can do in Washington to stop the president's hands is tired. He can't stop it. He just speaks in terms of how hopeless he is every time one happens. But one thing I believe can change the course of this country, I believe it gives us a lot more time. I believe it would be real prayer, old-fashioned, consecrated, fasting, pushing the plate back. My people call by my name, will what? Humble themselves and pray. Seek my face. I believe this is the answer today. Not only nationwide, but even locally here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Okay, here's what I want to ask you tonight. I want each one of you to respond, because I want you to see what I see, and because I have seen how God really can turn things around in a short period of time. I remember one of the first revivals I had down in a little town called Dumas, Arkansas. And it was a nice little church, a nice pastor. But we went in, and we always went in to our revivals with 3 days and three nights of fasting and prayer, because many of the saints did not pray in the Spirit in those days. They didn't pray in the Spirit. They received the Holy Spirit when they got born again. After they got born again. But most of them didn't practice their prayer language like we practice today. You know what I'm talking about? And many times their prayer language was just kind of limited to the initial, when you begin to stammer. It wasn't a clear, distinct language. And they prayed, they got the Holy Spirit, but they never developed a clear, distinct language. So whenever you went in revivals, you had to really fast and pray to break through that spirit and those limitations and barriers that they had there. And after usually 3 or 4 days, then you could see people really bursting forward and speaking clearly in their prayer language, just like they did when they first received it. Amen. And after that, souls began to get saved. I remember one of the first revivals I had, it was 100 teenagers saved in one revival. I was serious then. Amen. But my life was a life of fasting and prayer. There would be many times and many meetings that I had held, even sometimes one night. I remember a large church in Houston. I was there, and I remember preaching on the name of Jesus that night. And it was about 39 saints there. These were chronic, how many of you heard of chronic seekers? In those days, it was kind of difficult to get people filled with the Holy Spirit. Just the way that they did it, they had them saying, thank you, Jesus. Some of y'all don't. The whole church, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. You know, it worked for some people, so praise God for those that it did work for.
Amen.
But I never wanted to go through all of that. When I got saved and God called me to the ministry, it's a much easier way to get people filled with the Holy Spirit, teach them faith, and get them to expect, let them expect their prayer language when they first open their mouths. And so that night, to my surprise, but it should have been, 39 people received the Holy Spirit instantly. Amen. Nobody had to pat over them. Nobody had to say, hold on, let go. So I said, hold on, let go. And they told them to say a whole lot of things. But the thing that blessed me so is that you can teach people to receive the Holy Spirit so easily. He was a brother here the other day, and I had been trying to locate it for several sessions. Locate. Y'all know what I mean by locate? You have to find out where they are, how they think, and they have a whole lot of stuff in their minds, and you have to get beyond all of that. So finally, I finally located him, and every session he would come in complaining, my finances, my car, my van broke down. And every time it was some horror story. And I said, I don't want to hear another horror story. So that day, I made up my mind before I left home. I say, what this brother needs is a breakthrough in receiving the Holy Spirit today. My God. I came prepared because I knew he was going to receive it, and I talked with them about, because I had gone over a lot of the materials that pertain to the Holy Spirit. And that day, I said, brother, we're going to receive the Holy Spirit today. And 5 minutes, my brother was praising God like, I mean, like Brother Tidwell when he first received the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise God. And from that day to this day, his attitude has changed, his disposition has changed, his talk has, today I talked with him, I said, well, we're going to meet again on Friday. So we meet every week. And he said that, I said, how's everything going? Everything is going good. That's the first time I ever heard that. Everything is going good. So we just got to work with people until they get filled with the Holy Spirit. And then after they get filled with the Holy Spirit, they really need to develop a clear, distinct, flowing prayer language. And even going to the point of singing in the Spirit and just, you know, being led by the Holy Spirit in the Spirit, you know, by the Holy Ghost. Amen. While you're praising God in the Spirit. So we want to begin to flow, and I believe that the flow would be a lot greater, and I believe that the anointing would be a lot greater if we would submit to an old practice that we used to do years ago. Some still do it on a limited basis, and that's called fasting. Not eating fast, but fasting. So we want to institute that. I'm not sure whether some of you can actually do a 3-day fast anymore, like without anything except for water. That's the way we used to do it. Without water, no, with water. We did it with water. But some of the old saints did it what? Without water. They felt like if you took water, you avoided the fast. But I found out better because I had a friend that was a minister that he went about 20 days, I think, and he didn't take any water. And after when he passed away, that was a really shock to everybody. But water is good, and I think Kangen water is better. And some of you might know what I'm talking about. It gives you strength and energies. It's full of, anointing. It has electric charge. But no kidding, Kangen water has properties that other waters don't have, because it has the same properties that water contain that comes down the glacier sites, water that people travel for thousands of miles to drink from their streams. It has minerals, antioxidants, and things that the water that we normally drink don't have. So it's full of life. That's one thing about it. It's full of life. And when you drink it, you can always tell, because you can feel that energy vibrating through your system. So if you don't have access to that, Brother Wayne, you got one, right? Brother Wayne will help you out. Oh, yeah. Who else got one? Put the door. Brother Dallison, Irene. You know, I boast sometimes when I travel, because this is something that everybody seek out. Everybody want a Kangen water machine. And it's the number one in the world. But the thing is that I boast because in our local church here, you know, we've been teaching health and nutrition for a long time. And that's the reason why y'all a lot more healthy. They have the average churches around here. Like little sister Denise. What she went through a few years ago, but look how vibrant and strong and excited she is. Yeah. Amen. And Sister Julia Holman, she always used to pray every morning. She complained, oh, my knee back. This and that. She always just full of complaints. But now you drink very rarely. It's not all the water, but water has a lot to do with it. So I want to invite you to encourage you. We'll bring it. You know, I could bring a machine here. We have 25 or 30 machines in this church. And so that's really good, because it has really impacted. And we don't have those long healing lines. First month after everybody got on Kangen water, they began to sing. Let me give a testimony about the water. So he wanted to testify about the water. And after a month, their aches and pains began to dissipate, disappear, and got stronger, and blood sugar went down and all of that. Then they began to want their own machines. I believe Wayne was the first one, the first ones. Everybody was getting it from Derek Hill. He was the only one that had a machine initially. So they brought all of their jugs to the church on Wednesday night and Sunday. And everybody got concrete water. So we thank God for it because we have seen thousands and thousands of people impacted health-wise through that technology. So we praise God for it. Sister Tia is an expert. She knows how to do it all. And she gave a testimony of how, you know, she received a lot of miraculous things. But water will help us next week to endure hardness a little bit better when you're not eating the regular diet. Now, if you want to eat something like salads and fruit, I don't have no problems with that. But eliminate the eggs and the cheese and the salad dressing and what else, y'all, like bacon bits. Well, you know, y'all don't understand when you make sacrifices and really gain control over your appetite. That gives you the ability to restrain yourself in a whole lot of different other areas. You really need to get control of your appetite. You know, sometimes we go out with some of our friends, sisters and brothers, man, they order, you know, a slab of ribs. I mean, no, they don't call it a slab at the restaurant.
Rack.
Side.
Rack.
A rack. Yeah, a rack. Sometimes I shudder. I said, man, I wish I could eat like that. But no, you know, no offense to nobody that, you know, like that. But I feel like a simple diet. You know, I'm abstaining from meats most of the time, a lot of meats, and mostly raw vegetables and fruit, or steamed vegetables is what I try to stick to, because I know what it has done for me all of these years. Amen. Health-wise, spiritual-wise, and my home, and the blessing of the Lord has restored our lives. Okay, I want to do this because I want you all to be involved in this. I'm going to ask this question, and I want you all to respond to it. Some of you that feel led to respond to it. What specifically would you like the Lord to do for you during the upcoming season of prayer and fasting? Amen. That's a good question. Could be pertaining to your ministry, your gift, your talent. Because I'm going to tell you, you all really denied yourself a little bit more. Those talents and those gifts that God has placed in you, they would just begin to burst forth. That's the way they used to have revivals. They would pray, and they would have the singing lady to stand up and just sing until she, till everybody break and cry, and the Holy Spirit start moving, the gifts start what? Operating. Amen. And then they could go on and do whatever the Spirit, you know, wanted to do that night. But the singing was a major part of it. And y'all don't know how singing them psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, and letting God use you. God can use you. It seems like people that really sing from the bottom of their heart, it seems like they can get their release or breakthrough a lot easier that way than just trying to just pray and, you know, in the regular way. And even when I sing, I get my breakthrough. Glory. And so I want the singers to feel released. Let God use you. And 1 Peter 4:9, just turn that just for a second. We want God to use our using. A lot of y'all have these gifts and anointings and the ministry gifts. But we want you to let go and let God, because I believe that this is the season that God wants to really show himself strong in this particular church. It won't take a lot of fasting, but it's going to take some. It's going to take some diligence. In 1 Peter 4:9, it says this, verse 10, as every man has received the gift, even so minister the same one to another. Right, as good stewards of the manifold grace of what? God. If any man speak, let him what? Speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. So we want God to be glorified just in those 3 days, but in January, we're going to have some more extensive consecrations. And personally, I plan to spend some quality time in prayer, and I'm going to try to do it to perfect my singing in the Spirit. Singing in the Spirit. I like to sing some spiritual, you know, the Word of God can be turned into spiritual song. Every scripture that I read, I can almost turn it into some kind of song in the Spirit. Amen. Might not sound good to y'all, but it should give me the breakthrough I want. But I want you to just vocalize what you would like the Lord to do for you. Because we need to kind of know where you are, what your wants and desires are, what you're praying for, what you're believing for. And if we know that, then I believe it will set the stage for God to begin to release us in all of these different areas of our ministries. All right, some might have material needs that you might be seeking, but I know that seek ye first the kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness. And all the what? But these things. Every time I begin to fast and pray and seek God and, you know, get away from the TV and all of the distractions, my finances always experience a big, big, big transformation. Always. So if anybody have any financial needs, amen. Fasting and prayer. Not only in fasting and prayer, but also your healing will also what? Break full of speed. That's the word of God. I read this evening, Sister Hill showed me this. She wasn't able to come tonight. She said that when people lose 10 pounds, if a person loses 10 pounds, it will reduce the possibility of a heart attack by 50%. And when they lose or 10 pounds, it would reduce the possibility of diabetes going, you know, getting to be pre-diabetes. Doesn't always have to be full-blown diabetes. It will prevent that about 60% of the time. So when you begin to lose weight and to deny your flesh, a lot of things happen supernaturally. You know, not only just physically, but in Isaiah, I'm still going to ask you all these questions, but Isaiah says in 58, he says that, then shall that light, this is 58:8, then shall that light break forth as the morning, 58:8, and that health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. All right, look at verse 9. Then shalt thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, what? Here I am. If thou take away from the midst of thee the yoke, the putting forth of the finger, and speak in vanity, watch this. And if thou draw out thy soul to the hungry, and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall thy light rise in obscurity, and thy darkness be as the noonday. And the Lord shall guide thee continually,
and satisfy thy drought in thy soul in drought, and make fat thy bones, and thou shalt be like a water garden, and like a spring of water, whose what? Water fail not. And they that shall be of thee shall fill the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundation of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. So we have so many phenomenal promises in regard to fasting and prayer, and also in regard to reaching out to those that really need help. All types of phenomenal promises. All right, I just want to just everybody to respond to that. What specifically would you like the Lord to do for you during the upcoming season of prayer and fasting? All right, it can be natural, spiritually, ministry-wise, personal or whatever. So I want whoever of you want to respond first, raise your hand. All right, Brother Tidwell, okay.
I personally have a need to bring my flesh under subjugation, because I see that my health status is changing the person that I am, and I don't want to be affected by disease. And also, just in general, I feel like God is asking me to step out and not be determined by my circumstances, to extend my faith, to grow my faith more and step out more, because I'm not who I am because of where I am. I'm who I am because of God. So I need to step more that way and step out and do some things that are uncomfortable, and begin to try the faith and try God and grow spiritually, because that's the key for me. If I can grow spiritually, everything else will be added under me. So I'm not concerned about my circumstances, but I have a desire. I want to do more. I can't yet abound to every good work. And so I know that there's something wrong with what I'm doing, because I have that desire to abound toward every work, and I'm not doing it yet. So I think this is an opportunity for me, and it couldn't be any more time.
Those of you that don't know Brother Tidwell that well, you've been coming to this church for
eight years.
When you first came, you had received the Holy Spirit at one time, hadn't you?
I've been away from the
church. Practice, okay. And when you pray for him, the Holy Spirit doesn't gush down. You don't find too many men that release the way that he releases. So it's a lot in you, Brother Tidwell. And I'm glad that you spoke up and voiced your desires, your concerns. So everybody here heard that?
Yes.
Yeah, so this is how we can begin to locate where people are and really begin to focus on God meeting that particular need that he localized. All right, that was good, brother. It took a lot of courage to do that. Okay, anybody else? What do you want from God? All right, brother.
Well, I'm going to have to make it short, because Brother Tidwell just stepped on and said everything right out of my heart. It's on the head part of what I'm going through, having to be able to, like, sicknesses, particularly diabetes, is kind of hindering from doing what I'm supposed to do. And it's on my heart desire to do those things. But then, even with the marriage classes, the attack came down, and I had to, you know, I had to run to the restroom a lot and everything. But he just took it all, said it all as where I am and what I need and what I'm praying.
That's good. That's good. You know, a lot of times we don't feel chronic illness as being something that
that we can get release from. But when you begin to fast and pray, prayers go up to a different level. You know, sometimes people have confessed the word for 5 years. But when a group of people come together and fast and pray, the anointing is multiplied many, 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 many folds. And many times, you people that never expected to receive a supernatural miracle will receive it, because in unity, you know, there's strength. What do you think, you know, God can do a whole lot more when 50 people are fasting than when, how many, 500 are not fasting.
That's right, man.
But, you know, I'm pulling out all the stuff this time. It's a lot of us in this ministry that need healing. And I don't think that we have to tolerate all of these things that the devil brings.
Amen.
Prayer can remove it. The anointing can break what? Every yoke.
Yes.
And so all you need are a group of people that are real serious about God. And that anointing, that anointing, amen, gets to a certain level, amen, it will break every yoke. Every yoke. And we believe in God, because many in this ministry are in need of complete healing.
Amen.
And I'm glad that these two ministers are spoke up tonight, okay? Anybody else want to vocalize what you would like to see God do in your life?
I think for me it's vision, and it's kind of really piggybacking off of the same deal. Just clarity and vision through the knowledge of Him, you know. So it's a lot of times we mistake what it is for what it's about, and so healing. Prosperity is what it is.
Yes.
You see what I'm saying? I think sometimes we get lost in what trying to attain that which is, instead of seeking that which is about. And that's God's purpose.
Right.
And so for me it's that vision. Which has purpose. And I'd rather get lost in the purpose than get lost in sickness, disease, whatever, you know what I'm saying? And that causes me to get off of the purpose. So the purpose, that clarity of vision for myself, for my family, and really, but I know you said for yourself, but I believe that's the purpose of this church in particular,
right?
In terms of vision for our community. And so and we keep getting hit with it every week. I don't know if y'all realize that, but every week, whoever comes to minister, or if it's you, if it's a guest minister, vision, purpose. So that's really what I'm seeking in this at this time.
Right. Okay. Wonderful. You know, perfecting the love of God, you know, for one another, you know, that's... for all men, I think that this is the goal that we're all seeking for. We want to perfect the love that God has given us. We want to love each other as Christ has loved us. And in order to fulfill that vision, you know, you just have to, you know, faith works by what? By love. Amen. And without perfecting our love for each other, there are many things that we are studying concerning the things that God has actually commanded us to do, to minister, to reach out, to love one another in a way so that our faith will grow and we will actually experience the fullness of God. I believe the fullness of God will actually be released in our lives after we, amen, really reach out and walk the love walk and love each other as Christ has loved us. All right, Brother Holman, seems like you're about to say something. What would you like?
I mean, we all could probably say numerous things on this.
Yes, yes.
I personally, I guess, just trying to walk into contentment of knowing that God is for me. I mean, because, you know, you face your job, you face unbelievers, you face circumstances. I mean, it kind of challenged you 24/7 in today's time. So, I guess for me, just to be content in knowing that God is truly for me. Mm-hmm. And I think with fasting and prayer, which dropping a few pounds wouldn't hurt either. You know, in this case, in my case, because I really indulged this past holiday. But yeah, I would see God in a sense that I would want Him to, and just reveal that He is for me.
All right. All right,
anybody
else?
I would like to see, one thing about fasting is it helps you get your eating under control, because a lot of times we eat what we want, and by you pushing that plate back, it causes you to eat a certain way, eat healthier. I also have diabetes too. Almost lost my mom to it, so I want to make sure that I'm healthy for my children. And then that closeness with God, I want to get closer to Him. Make sure that I hear His voice only and follow.
Very good, very good. All right, Sister
Dorothy. To be honest with you, I am so excited about this.
Yeah.
I'm having to discipline myself not to go ahead, because then I'm jumping ahead of God, and I really want to participate in this. For about the last 6 months, I have been going through some deliverance, going to some classes, but doing a lot of things on my own. God has shown me things, brought up memories. Old wounds, old hurts that have opened the door for Satan, and he's had me to do one of two things: repent or forgive. And it's just that simple. And done a lot of cleansing of my bloodline and just that type of thing. And so this fast has just got me so excited, because I have, I'm going to say it like this: I have a small amount left of deliverance, and that's this pain in my knee. Well, I know this is not, I know it's demonic oppression. No sickness is of God, so all of them are oppression.
Yes.
And I have said to the Lord, I knew Pastor before, when you talked about the fast, that this is what was going to take place with me. I knew God was going to end this, show me what I needed to do for this. And the fasting was going to do it. And so I'm excited. I can't wait.
All right. Fasting will subjugate your flesh so that you can
hear God.
Hear God.
That's right.
And we'll put up and yield completely to Him. Okay? Brother William, do you think that since we are reaching out in the community, that we need this consecration?
Well, yeah, the community, fasting, but I would put the purpose on it for not so much me wanting anything from God, but kind of like in the position of Daniel's attitude. You know, the community, the country, the city, we need a revival.
Yeah, that's right.
They need the word. I know that the community will need some type of penetration of the presence of God. Because, I was just heard on the news, I guess this past weekend, we were at 46th and Johnstown. Guys who remember us, 49th in Johnstown, a 73-year-old woman got hit 20 times with a shovel. Anybody hear about that?
Yes, sir.
And, you know, I'm going, you know, this area, this community where we are planted needs some ministry. Because the kid that did it to her, he was 14 years old. And so I'm saying, you know, if we're not reaching kids, and I gotta say, we gotta stop overlooking people, because what if we would have planted into that guy's life 4 or 5 years ago?
Yeah.
Or, you know, and then the ones that we are planting into, let's look forward. What are they gonna be like, these 9-year-olds, fast forward 5 years, 10 years? So, you know, my heart is that, you know, that I can be a minister, can carry, can plant, can be a seed, can be anything, some type of work for this community, some type of gospel work, the gospel in this community, because we, you know, that's what I think we really, really need.
I think the fasting will strengthen those that will be reaching out, and give them that zeal and fervor and determination to hold on and stick in there until they get some marked results, which will come easy. The Bible says the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, but the violent will what? Take him by force. And I think that it needs something like fasting and prayer to put something that's a necessity into us, so that we will be determined that we will actually reap the harvest.
And, you know, it's not to pray for a harvest. That would be, to me, a waste of time. Fields are white, ready for harvest.
Oh, yes. Right.
So pray for laborers.
Right. Laborers, all right. Laborers. All right. Laborers don't want those kind of challenges. The average laborer.
Pray for laborers.
And the spirit of God, you know, one of the things that I realized, too, is that, you know, I heard somebody say, and it's so true. Some things have to be caught. Some things, you know, some things come by teaching, but some things have to be caught. So, you know, when we begin to get serious in this thing, I really think that the spirit of God will hover around. You'll see the spirit of our community change, you know what I'm saying? And the hearts would be ready to receive the word, you know. But I just think right now, everybody going about their merry way, and until we do what we're doing now, is when that spirit, you know what I'm saying, will begin to infiltrate our communities, and then be open to receive, you know. And so sometimes we can labor. But then sometimes if the spirit ain't there, then our labor is in vain.
Right.
You know, and so I get excited because this is really some foundational things that's gonna open up, you know, our community to the kingdom.
Absolutely.
You know?
So. Right. Oh, that's good. Come on, Sister Denise, you got anything?
I have to go online now, but many years ago I read the story of William Seymour, and as you were talking, I'm like, I'm proud of the spirit of William Seymour, and he was the one that did something. How was spirit doing for him?
I remember.
I don't remember, it was too long ago, but William Seymour, I mean, I'll just paraphrase this, it was like he had set a fire, and everyone came surrounding, cities came to that fire burn. I mean, as introducing the Holy Spirit, I mean, it's just revival that broke out when William said that. Going to take revival, and it's going to cause us to get closer. God is going to allow us to be on one accord, and I believe this fasting is going to be the beginning. I believe this is going to be a ripple effect. We're just going to continue, and it's going to be something, Pastor. I believe that we're all going to just get on board, and it's not going to be something we're going to have to cry and beg us to do.
Right.
I just believe that it's the season.
That's good. I'm glad to hear
you. I'm going to have to look that up. William Seymour, if you have time, just kind of do some background with William Seymour.
Right.
Amen.
All right. Jeremy, you got anything? What would be your motivation?
Well, I don't know when the fasting is. I heard 3 days.
Okay.
But, he
can't come on Sunday, so we have to let him know every night on Wednesday night. And we appreciate him when he does come on Saturday, right?
Some Saturdays and Wednesday.
Yeah, Wednesday, right. Okay, well, next Wednesday, we will be in this consecration. Next Wednesday night? Okay, that would be a good night for you. Thursday night, maybe. So you can worry about that.
So Wednesday and Thursday?
Wednesday, Thursday, right.
We got to be here?
Yeah. Okay. All right. Sister Deborah is reaching out to 50. She sent out 50 to 100 announcements. So there's a possibility that we might have quite a few people involved in this. So I'm looking forward to all that God sends so that we can already put our numbers together. We should receive greater results. All right, Brother Wayne, Brother Wayne has a unique testimony on how. Now, he has experienced supernatural healing from a chronic ailment, maybe, but whenever you talk about a genuine miracle that a person has received, I always point to Brother Wayne, because the doctor had given him a very, very unfavorable report. He held on to the Word, he held on to God, and he rejected a whole lot of the... Well, I don't want to take your testimony. how do you think that this type of revival could impact people that are looking for that type of fulfillment?
I think you can receive whatever you desire and from him. If you persevere, be persistent about what you believe him for. And, fight with, of course, with faith, resisting whatever the enemy try to bring against you. And during this time of seeking him, I believe you can receive whatever you desire from God, receive it. Because to me, it ain't no different receiving salvation or his healing otherwise. It's in his word and what he say for us to have made available for us. And, I'd be the first one to say that the devil tried to bring different symptoms back that maybe transpired to, about, like you said, 8 years ago. And I do the same thing, what I did then, same thing, basically the same thing what Jesus did when he came and tempted Jesus. Jesus said, what is written? It is written. God's word already been said about him, and he knew that. And what God's word has said about us for his healing, say the same thing all over again. It's written by his stripes I'm here. And I just continue to stand on that no matter what comes. And God, I believe through his word and me trusting in him and made up my mind and convinced that what I have received is not going to let the devil take away from me. And I think it's something that we all look forward to doing. And like I said, I believe you can receive whatever you desire. What are you asking for? Yeah. And I think about 2 weeks ago when I had told Travis this, there was something that had went on, was going on the job, and I feel like I wanted to deal with it, even at a manager level. And that Monday night, I came to prayer. Came in a group and prayed, and I just told God I really don't want to deal with this, but if I have to, I will. And I had made up my mind that next day I was going to, we were supposed to be having a meeting that morning. We went to the room to have our meeting. I know the several guys went into the meeting. They turned around and came back to the meeting and canceled. I'm like, I want to, there's something I needed to talk about, issues I needed to address. And as the day went on, and come to find out the very thing that I would feel like I was going to have to address, it had already been taken care of.
Wow. Praise God.
I mean, it just really blew, and I really believe because we came together that particular evening as saints prayed together, even though they might not knew what I was praying for. But the unity of the spirit and coming together and agreeing mm-hmm. on one accord and one mind, God met my need.
Yes.
I mean, the whole thing was just, I didn't have to do nothing. But praise God and give him the glory for it. And that's, you know, we can expect it now. I feel like I'm at a time, it's my season to receive. Yes. Even on this trip that we went to this Louisiana, my wife, she had made reservation like last year, January. And somehow when we got there for the hotel that we had booked, when I went in there to check in, they said, we don't have no room available for you. And come to find out, the very car that she booked the reservation for, somehow the other, I think she remembers the bank caller told us compromised, and they issued us another card. Well, it didn't go through because the card was canceled. But his man tells us, well, we don't have no room. All the rooms have been booked. But we called one of my nieces where they was had the room, or they were able to get us room, and it saved us about $300
wow.
cheaper than what we would have been at the other one.
Wow. Praise God.
Like I said, I believe this is my season. When you see God, when God begin to stir things amongst us and begin to add and begin to bring people in, begin to do things, begin to show himself on our behalf, receive all that he has for, and know for a fact that he is moving and he is working.
Yes.
This water that we've been believing for is being stirred. And then you can sit back and wait and say, well, that's the favorite thing that I believe I'm going to be praying for, is hearing God's voice and moving in a time that when he speaks to me, I do it. Because I have believed, I have missed some times that he has spoke to me to do something. I reason myself out of it. Or I say, well, people don't really want to hear that. But I know when I do what God say do, blessings, not only on me, and I believe from people that I have input in their life, come back and say the very same thing that I needed to hear from. So I say for myself, it's my time. This consecration is for me, from what I want to hear from God, that I move in the time that he say move. I want to step with him. I want to do what he say to do. Because I know in doing that, that's where my blessing lies, being obedient to him. So I believe it's a very, very crucial and very important time that we can receive from God, we desire and want to see whatever we believe him for.
All right, we all getting on board.
Yes.
Getting on board. Travis, you want to say something?
I have something to say. A couple of months ago, I've been dealing with, I was trying to get him and his girlfriend to come to church. And I was trying to leave her out because of my past. Because of my past. You know, and now I'm not holding anything, I'm holding anything against it. You know, and I've forgiven and all of that. But my spirit was challenging me, wouldn't let me rest. And my spirit finally spoke to me and asked me, what was I doing? And the whole time, I knew what it wanted me to do, but I was trying not to hear. I didn't want to do it. But God said to me, who am I? Said, who are you to decide who gets saved and who don't? And you know, when I heard that, you know, it just kind of hit me real hard. So I gave in, and I asked them all to come to church, you know, about 3 weeks ago or so. I asked all three. Well, it didn't happen, but after I did that, of course, my spirit was at rest, but it wasn't for God, but it wasn't enough. God didn't want me to stop there. He wanted me to do more. So, of course, the devil stepped right in. No sooner than I asked him to come to church, the devil tried to split them all up. You know, they were over there at each other's throats. Everybody just wanted to leave. So I went over there Sunday before last and ministered to them and counseled with them. And so much bitterness and stuff toward each other. I stayed about an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours. And when I left there, I felt comfortable about what I did. But I didn't hear anything from them for a week, not till yesterday, actually. And I found out that they had a nice Thanksgiving together. Everybody made up. They're getting ready to move into another place. And so what I need for God on this fast is to allow me to look at myself and to challenge me about what do I really feel, you know, where am I really in Christ? Because I thought I had truly forgiven, but I found out that I was holding back. And I don't want to be that way. That's not who I am. At least that's who I did think I was. So I want God to really challenge me and look at me and face me. And if they are, you know, so any of those other weaknesses that I don't think I have, I want them revealed to me so I can do away with it. So I can move forward with them and get them here.
Excellent, excellent. I really appreciate it. It's time for us to, kids are coming, it's time for us to stand. And we want to do a closing prayer. We really pray that God will bring the saints together on one accord. Sunday we will begin to focus more on this. And we just believe that this consecration is going to lead to something that God really has wanted to do for a long time in this body. So we are going to pray at this time. Who wants to lead the prayer?
I get it. Lord, I thank you first for this opportunity for us all to be here together. Father God, even as we leave this place, that you'll start stirring up things in our spirit, Father God. Prepare us for this consecration, Father God, that we might receive of you like never before. Let there be an outpouring like never before, Father God. And help us to know ourselves and know the things that we need to release and let go. And we need to surrender and let you do the work in us. And Father, we ask that we leave here and everybody get home safely. And have a good night. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. 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 Amen.